Drones are dropping off food to Icelandic backyards, vaccines from Rwandan skies, and blood samples in North Carolina.
These things went from toys to tools that we might be able to use on a commercial scale.
Drones have reached a tipping point. They're inspecting hard-to-reach places and even responding to emergencies. The largest drone delivery network in the world just launched in Ghana. And tech companies and research institutions around the world are closer than ever to making drones safe enough to operate alongside the rest of the airplanes in the sky. I'm Kaylee Hope. This is Quartz. Please subscribe to our channel. Switzerland has become a hub of innovation for drones. It's home to some of the world's leading researchers, working not just to make better drones, but to make them safe to fly on a large scale.
If there is an obstacle, then the drone can autonomously figure out how to circumvent it.
Margarita Healy is a professor at ETH, a leading robotics university in Zurich. Students here are working to build more agile drones that can fly on their own in any direction. Eventually, they might be used to assess damage on large structures like bridges. But for that to be really useful, these drones need to steer themselves to avoid hitting things. So Margarita's team is also using cameras on board the aircraft to map the environment.
As the drone takes off, it starts capturing data from the environment and building up a map. We have come a long way. We are seeing drones, for example, able to fly with some degree of autonomy. But this idea of flying from point A to point B completely autonomously, no matter the environment and no matter the weather, that's going to take a few more years to see.
And for those drones to become part of our daily lives, we'll also need ways to track them. The Swiss plan to launch the first ever system allowing drones to communicate with airplanes and air traffic controllers. And in the US, NASA is also working to build a similar system.
The basic rule of the airspace for normal aviation is the pilot's always looking out for another airplane. With drones, we don't have that.
Mark Blanks is the director of the Mid-Atlantic Aviation Partnership at Virginia Tech. It's one of 9 test sites selected by the FAA to help accelerate drone innovation. He's testing the technology needed to allow drones to fly vast distances over lots of people safely.
We're looking at millions of new operators, people that were not traditional aviators. And anytime we have a new entrant like drone technology, it disrupts the system.
Airports and cities across the world, like Newark, Gatwick, Dublin, and Dubai, have all grounded planes and absorbed millions of dollars of losses after drones were spotted flying nearby.
Now we are having to use either technology or people on the ground to prevent collisions from occurring.
His team evaluates tech to help drones avoid collisions. They're also looking at systems to help law enforcement remotely identify drones, and if a drone is someplace it shouldn't be, to shut it down.
In order to enable a technology, you also have to be able to disable the technology.
The level of scrutiny for the reliability and safety of this technology is as high as it's ever been for any technology.
Dr. Gann is an ENT surgeon at Wake Med Hospital in Raleigh, North Carolina, that became the only hospital in the U.S. to transport blood supplies by drone. The state wants to use drones for medical deliveries because they're cheaper and more efficient. Deliveries by road couriers can take several hours, but the drone flights are just 3 minutes.
For us, clinically, that makes a big difference. We are always trying to improve the speed with which we can process. On the other end of that lab request is the need to get the result to help a patient.
The hope is that drones won't just make things cheaper, they'll make us safer. When Hurricane Florence was heading to North Carolina, the Department of Transportation used drones to make decisions on where to send resources.
It's a great tool to educate the community about where the roads were cut off or the extent of the flooding. And that conversation really helped people understand why they needed to stay off our roads.
I mean, we're just reaching that tipping point now. And the industry is just starting to take root. And this project is helping to create the regulatory frameworks that'll be necessary to make that possible.
So I think what you'll see in the next couple of years here is not just demonstration here, there, and around, but true, broad operations that help the public in many different ways.
Hey, we're making a series for Quartz members we think you'll like. It's called Because China. China is reshaping our world in a lot of interesting and unexpected ways. Click the link in the description or the comments and sign up for a free membership trial to watch this series and more great videos.